Good morning. We are glad you're here this morning. Let's everyone stand. As we say the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now the pledge of allegiance to the Christian flag.
I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty to all who believe.
The pledge of allegiance to the Bible.
I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and will hide its word in my heart, that I may not sin against God.
Lawrence, pray for us.
Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you thanking you, Lord, for your Son Jesus, who loved us enough that he went to that old rugged cross and gave his life, that we might have a plan of salvation if we just accept it. So, Lord, we just pray that people realize they need to go to him and ask him to forgive them of their sin and shortcomings and get baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit and live for him the rest of their life. We ask all these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
All right, you'll remain standing. 334. 334. Blessed assurance, Jesus is coming.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God. Oh, heavenly Spirit, washed with blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all as I grasp. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Song, praising my Savior exalted, the King is exalted on high.
I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name.
But I don't know why.
what to say. I don't know where to start. But as you give the grace, with all that's in my heart, I will sing. Tragedy that we don't give enough thought to. I looked at a video or picture this yesterday, I think it was, of some rap singer named Lil Wayne who was tromping on an American flag. And, you know, granted, you know, we fight for the liberties to have the expression of freedom of speech and all this kind of stuff, but for somebody that's in the public eye like that to lay a flag on the ground and walk on it as spitting in the face of every soldier that has died to make this country great. It's a tragedy.
Amen.
But you know, we serve a risen Savior.
Amen.
He is in the world today.
Amen. Amen.
And I know from personal experience that he lives. So let's sing this song and let's just show the people like that person Christ is Lord. And we're going to take up the offering on the last verse. He lives.
Risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always here. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my terrible way. He lives, salvation to my heart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Because you are so Christian, lift up your voice and sing.
Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King. Of all who seek Him, the helper of all who cry, the Father is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my narrow way.
Chapter 10 this morning. I'm going to be reading from verse 21 through 24. 21 through 24. Luke chapter 10 says, "At that hour Jesus rejoiced in spirit, and he said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudent, and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for it seemed good in thy sight. All things are delivered to me of my Father, and no man knoweth who the Son is but the Father, and who the Father is but the Son, and he whom the Son will reveal him. And he turned unto his disciples, and he said privately, Blessed are the eyes which see the things that ye see. For I tell you that many prophets and kings have desired to see those things which ye see, and have not seen them, and to hear those things which ye hear, and have not heard them." Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for the reading of your word. I pray, Father, you'd hide me behind the cross. Father, give us wisdom and guidance as we share your word today. Help us to stay attuned to the scripture, attuned to the spirit. And Father, we'll be careful to give you the praise and the glory. Father, you speak, and let us hear with our hearts. Let us be obedient today. And Father, we'll be careful to give you the praise. For we ask it in Jesus' name, for his sake we pray. Amen. This gospel was written by Luke, the beloved physician, most likely around AD 70, It was written to give a connected and orderly narrative of the life of Christ as seen by eyewitnesses. Internal evidence indicates that this book was written especially for the Gentiles, of which all of you, I believe, are a part. So he tells us today that it's inferred to us because that the Jewish customs and sometimes substitutes Greek names for Hebrew, but that's how we know. One hindrance to hearing a word from God may be our own wisdom. Many times, wisdom, like success, can deceive us. It can deceive us into thinking that we should take the role of teacher rather than student. Now, that's not an excuse to not become a teacher, but sometimes we need to be sure of where we get our wisdom from. Our knowledge lulls us into thinking we have sufficient wisdom to meet any challenge, is the thing he's implying. So he tells us that believing we're wise sometimes tempts us to evaluate our shortcomings of others, and we judge others. Yet we can be many times unaware of how much growth we still need within ourselves. I've been in church for many, many years, and I'm still growing. God is still teaching me. And I hope and pray he's doing that with you today. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the reading of your word. And Father, I pray that you would just give us wisdom again, Father, and help us to lean on you. And Father, we'll be careful to give you the praise. But we ask it in Jesus' name. For his sake we pray. Amen. Amen. He tells us several things more now than scripture, and just not many verses today, but I want you to recognize what he's saying. He says, first of all, there's a superiority and a privilege. You see, the privileges that God gives to us as Christians, the privileges that he offers to us today, he wants us to realize they come from him. You're not going to get them anywhere else. You're not going to be able to buy it. It's not something that you can earn by doing certain things. That is not what he's saying here. He says there in verse 21 that Jesus said in that hour he rejoiced in his spirit. That word in the Greek means much more than what we think of when we think of rejoicing. Okay, I'm rejoicing because I'm here this morning. But he's saying that it's rejoicing in such a way that Jesus was exuberant. He was filled full of joy about what was taking place as he recognized the power of God and how it was working. And so he's careful to point this out to us here. The scripture in the Greek actually means that his joy actually leaped in his heart. The same kind of leap that we'll discuss here shortly in a few weeks about Jesus when he was born and Mary said that joy leaped in her heart. The same kind of joy here is what he's talking about. So he's pointing this out to us, and he says that he was grateful for God's divine plan. Are you grateful today for God's plan? I mean, earnestly. Think about it. Think about what God's done and what he's supplied for us. I am grateful today for God's plan. We don't have to sacrifice animals up here on the altar anymore to pay for our sins. Jesus came to earth and died once and for all to be able to make the supreme sacrifice, so we would not have to do that. But we come into a holy place when we come here. It's still a holy place. And so God tells us here that Jesus says, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudent, and you've revealed them unto babes. Now, many times we read that scripture and we don't understand what it's saying here. He says, I've hid these things from the wise and prudent. Well, we think those are wise and those are prudent. Those are understanding will be those who will understand the Word of God, be able to receive the Word of God. But what he's telling us is, oftentimes, and we found this quite often in the Old Testament, that those who were the religious leaders, those who should have known, oftentimes did not know, okay? So he wants us to realize that. He tells us here, he says, I thank thee, O God. The Greek there means that I thank thee, I agree with thee, Father. I am in a total, complete agreement with you. Are you in total, complete agreement with Christ today? Are you in agreement with what God has shared with you today? That's what he's telling us. He says, my conscience agrees with this. My conscience agrees with what God is doing. My conscience agrees with what God has given me and what he's instilled within me. My conscience agrees with that. And that's what he wants us to realize today. I have too many people that call me and they talk to me sometimes and they don't understand why they're in the position they're in. They don't understand why they're longing. They don't understand why there's something missing in their life. Because they've not received what he's talking about here. He's not talking about knowing about Jesus. He's not talking about believing that he was a prophet that lived 2,000 years ago. He's talking about having a personal relationship with God. Amen. Like Jesus had. And that's what he's telling us here today. He says that we're to realize this and understand what he's talking about here. He says, because you've hid these things from the wise and the prudent. Now, if you look up the wise in the Greek, you'll find out that that means that those who were kind of discerned spiritually. The wise were the ones that were kind of discerned spiritually. They kind of thought they had it by the tail. Paul was one of those in the original. He said he believed in the Word of God. He understood the Word of God. He taught the Word of God. Yet he did not understand it the way God wanted him to understand it. He hadn't received the Spirit of God. And that's what he's telling us here that we need to look at today. The prudent. Prudent people are those that have discernment. Those are people that have somewhat of an understanding, seemingly can understand what's being done, and they can understand what's taking place. And so sometimes we can get educated. You've seen people before, they've been educated, and yet they didn't know a thing about common sense. They didn't know a thing about being able to deal with real life. And that's what he's talking about here. So he tells us God has revealed his plan to babes. What does he mean by babes? He means to those who are earnestly seeking him, okay? Children will come without question. Children will follow. He said little children will lead them. Little children will bring them to an understanding. So he wants us to realize that what he's sharing with us here is that we can have discernment, we can have knowledge, we can have understanding, we can read God's Word, we can sit in a Sunday school class and somewhat understand it. That doesn't make you a Christian. You must receive the Spirit of God. You must receive that like a little child, like a little baby here. He says babes. It's those that are innocent, those that are not so caught up in themselves that they believe they can handle it no matter what, that they believe they don't need God. And we can get that way. We can get that way even as Christians. We believe we don't need God. And so he tells us to look at that and to understand that today. He says, not only is there a superiority of the privilege here today, but he says there's the giving of the privilege. The giving of the privilege. Who does he give the privilege to? Well, he tells us already that he's explained here that he doesn't give it to those that are wise, those that are prudent, those that think they understand. He gives it to those who are willing to seek, those who are willing to find. And he explains that even to his disciples today, I think, as he's looking at this. We take for granted so often in looking at the scriptures that the Holy Spirit just falls, and it just falls on everybody, okay? But God says we must be seeking. We must be earnestly wanting to find. We must be wanting to understand, wanting to discern what God's sharing with us. He says this, if you want to turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And I want to read from verses 26 and 27. He says this. He says, for ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. Now called, remember that I said last week, the week before when I was talking about God's plan, God has a plan. He issues a calling to all. But not everybody understands. Not everybody accepts. Not everybody comprehends what the Spirit is leading, what the Spirit's saying. But he says, God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. He's telling us there that a lot of times people do not comprehend because they are not looking in the right avenues. They're not perceiving what the Spirit is saying. He says there's many that are wise that are foolish. They're after the flesh. He looks at that in there. He says that they're after the flesh. They comprehend things from a fleshly outlook. That's what he said. We must comprehend things from a spiritual outlook. There's a lot of things that the scriptures explain for us that is a mystery to me and you. It's a mystery if we don't seek the Word of God, if we don't understand what God's pointing out to us. So he says it will confound the wise. In other words, they'll not understand. They'll not comprehend what he's saying, even though they may be very educated, might have a 102 IQ. but they don't understand what God's saying, okay? He says, God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound those who are mighty, those who are strong, those who think they are okay. He says, they confound them. What does he mean? He means it's not given to those who are self-inspired. It's not given to those who think they have everything under control. God levels the playing field. He doesn't care how rich you are. He doesn't care how poor you are. He doesn't care how good looking you are. He doesn't care what color you are. God says it's not about what you think. It's not about what you think, but it's about what God determines. Amen. So he says here that he confounds those things which are mighty, those things that are mighty. He says not only is it in the giving of the privilege, but he tells us it's in the goodness that's revealed in his privilege, because he says here, thou hast hid these things from the wise and revealed it unto babes, even so, rather, for it seemed good in thy sight. It seemed good in thy sight. That's why that we can look at the Bible and we don't understand how God could love somebody like David that committed so many sins, that was involved in so much wrong, and yet he forgave him and he said, he is a good man, he is a man after my heart. That's what God's looking at. He's looking on the inside. He's not looking at the outside. He knows what we are determining to seek out. And so through that, he shares his wisdom with us. Not out of books, not out of anything. You can even read the Bible. I know people that read the Bible and are lost as a goose. Okay? He says they don't understand it. His disciples said, Father, why do you teach in parables? Because not everybody understands it. He said, because it will confound the wise. They'll not understand. He said, those who are seeking, those who are truly wanting to find, they will seek and they will find. So he tells us that it is important because he says, for it seemed good in thy sight. Good in his sight is the criteria for making all judgments. It doesn't matter what you think. It doesn't matter what I think. It doesn't matter what the Pope thinks. It only matters what God thinks.
Amen.
Okay? It only matters what God thinks. And God sees and is all-knowing. The Scriptures tell us that. What he's telling us is that the wise, many times, within their hearts, they don't see a need for God. They feel that they are self-made men, self-made women. They have the world by the tail, so to speak. They have everything under control. They do not need God in their life. But I can tell you all the time, I have people calling me and saying, I need to get back in church. I need to get my life right with God. Coming to church is not going to get your life right with God. Coming to church is not going to save you. You must receive Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You must understand the wisdom that's behind the word that God is sharing today. We must receive that wisdom as a baby. We must receive what God's sharing with us. Amen. So he says, it'll be confounded by the wise. The wise will be confounded because they'll determine that they don't need God. Not only that, but they kind of feel like they're in a different class. You've seen people like that. They feel like, well, I'm better than those people over there at Grace Baptist. I need a better church. I need a fancier church. I need a preacher that jumps and shorts and snorts and shouts. And, I just need that. I need one of them hound dogger preachers. You know. God says, share the word, and it will speak openly to them.
Amen.
That's what he says. So he says, if we share that, in this way, then those people that are confounded, the wise that are confounded, they feel like they don't need God, they feel like they have everything under control, he says, they'll begin to be awakened. Because what he shares with us here is very, very important. See what he says there in verse 20? This is the most important thing. I should have included it in my reading probably, but in verse 20 he says that it's important your names are written in heaven. It's important that your name is written in heaven. That's all that matters. That's all that matters. All the other stuff doesn't matter. All that matters is your name written in heaven. That's what's important. And you need to determine that today before you leave. You need to decide today, is my name written in heaven? You say, well, preacher, I don't know. Well, he tells us that he has written things down and recorded them for us so that we can understand. If we're seeking to find him, we can understand what he's saying. So he says, listen closely to what's being said, and you'll comprehend it, because I believe God will give you a spirit that will open your heart and he'll be able to pour it inside. Doesn't matter what I preach, God can use it and he can pour it inside your heart today if you'll listen and pay attention. So he says there's a superiority of the privilege. Point two today. He tells us there's those that are selected by the privilege. Now I know when we say selected, we say, oh preacher, maybe I'm not in that chosen bunch. That's not what he's talking about there, okay? He's saying, I predetermined, I pre-planned. Remember last week, week before, I was talking about he's building a house. He's building us. He's constructing us. He's making changes in us. He's following the blueprint. He's following the plan. He's already laid the print out. He's already laid the plan out. He says, so I've selected those for a privilege. He says there in verse 22 and 23, he says, no man knoweth who the Son is but the Father, and who the Father is but the Son. We know who Jesus says he is, but the only way I can know Jesus and the only way you can know Jesus today is to know the Son. You must know the Son in order to know the Father. That's what he says. So he's very clear about that. He says, because he whom the Son will reveal him. Jesus came that he might reveal to us God. He came that he might reveal the persona of God to us. He is God incarnate, come to earth that he might reveal the presence of God to me and you. But we must be open to it. We must understand it. We must receive it. So he says that God is only going to reveal that to those who are earnestly seeking. He's going to reveal it to those who are earnestly seeking the Father. That means we must come earnestly wanting to learn, earnestly wanting to receive, earnestly wanting to understand who Jesus is today. It doesn't do you any good just to come to church. Okay? Doesn't do you any good to put money in an offer plate. Doesn't do you any good to read your lesson, Sunday school lesson, if you've not received Jesus Christ. You can do all that and miss the point that he's telling us here. He says it's very important because no man knoweth who the Son is. He said, you're not going to know who Jesus is. You say, well, I know who Jesus is. He's a prophet that lived 2,000 years ago. No, he's much more importantly trying to explain to you that you need to know him. Know him. Don't know who he is. Don't know about him. Know him. Know who he is. Receive him into your heart and life. He says, because there's divinity in the selection. Because what he's telling us is to whom the Son will reveal him. God does the seeking of the spiritual privilege. God says, here's the guidelines. If you come seeking as a child, if you come wanting to understand who I am, I will reveal myself to you. But you must come as a child, he says, because no man knows who the Son is. The only way you're going to know who God is to know him through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So you must know who he is. You must know who Jesus is. Don't miss that this morning. He says, because it's through this divinity and this selection that Jesus will reveal to you who God is. And then there's the disciples in the Revelation, because he speaks about his disciples, and he says he turns to his disciples, and he said unto them privately, he says, blessed are the eyes of those which see the things that you see. He was trying to help them to find out that they were very blessed to know Jesus. You know, I thought about that, and I think, you know, I know Jesus, and I have him in my heart, and I've received him, but what a blessing to walk around with the Lord. What a blessing to be there and to see him, to hear him speak. What a blessing to see him do the miracles that he did. What a blessing to just see Jesus in action.
Amen.
They were very, very blessed. Very blessed. But he tells us that we're blessed as well, because he says the divine knowledge of these things is the greatest knowledge that you can have in the entire world. Doesn't matter how many books you buy, you can own every library, every book that the Dayton Library has, and it will not give you the knowledge you'll find in this book.
Amen.
It will not give you the knowledge that you'll understand if you receive Jesus Christ. So he tells us it's important. He says there's no other greater knowledge to be known or undertaken and understood in this world. There's no knowledge that can surpass knowing God in a personal way. Not knowing about God, knowing God in a personal way. That's what he's saying. So he says that as we do that, he will reveal to us, because as you read this word, as you understand who Jesus is, he'll reveal to you his love. He'll reveal to you his understanding. How does he do that? He does that through parables. I just spoke a while ago and said his disciples asked him, why do you use these parables? He said, I use them because those who are seeking, those who are wanting to understand, it will be revealed to them. But those who are looking at it will look at a story and they'll not see it. They'll not understand what's being revealed. He says that he revealed it through parables. He did something much greater than that, though. He taught us through his word. It is important that he taught us through his word. But catch this. He taught us through his living example. Jesus taught us through his life, through the way that he lived here on earth. The Bible says he was tempted in all the ways that you and I are tempted, and yet he had no sin in his life.
Amen.
That's important. That's important. So he tells us that he taught us by his life relationship, by how he lived his life. As he was confronted by Satan, and Satan tried to tempt him, he told him through Scripture, he said, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Amen. He set an example for us. He lived by example. He lived by example. So he tells us that it's important for us to understand that. He revealed something else to us other than just living by example. He revealed to us that he had a special relationship to the Lord. Special relationship. Do you have a special relationship to God this morning? Do you have a special relationship to Jesus Christ? It's important. It's important because Jesus had a special relationship with God, and he wants us to have that special relationship with him.
Amen.
That's what he's telling us. He says he revealed it through his parables, through his teaching, through his life. He revealed it through his relationship. And he revealed himself to us that we might be able to know God. Because he says, they don't know you because they don't know me. That's the truth. They don't know you, God, because they don't know me. You must know Jesus Christ. That's the most important thing today. Ask yourself today as you look at this, do I feel like I really need God in my life, or is it just a formality? Is it just something that I come to do because I feel like I'm responsible? I need to come to church. I need to come to church. I need to put a little money in the offering plate. I maybe need to study my Sunday school lesson or time. But do you really put anything into it? Do you really seek God's wisdom and guidance here? We're to place our destiny in God's hands, what he tells us. We're to place our destiny in God's hands. That means that God condemns. He doesn't condemn intelligence. He condemns being self-sufficient. He condemns those that think they are wise beyond their understanding. That's what he's saying. He's telling us today that we need to not have intellectual pride and self-sufficiency. Self-sufficiency. I don't care how much you know and how learned that you are, you need to depend upon God. You need to depend upon Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And that's what he's telling us today. Ask yourself this, how did I come to Christ? If you're a Christian here today, how did I come to Christ? How did I get to know about Christ? Maybe you read about it in this book. Maybe you heard some silly preacher up here preaching about it, and you understood about that. That's how I received Jesus Christ. I knew. I've gone to church all my life. I thought I was a Christian. But I heard from Brother Bowen that you must be saved. You must invite Jesus into your heart and life. You must receive him as your Savior.
Amen.
You must come as a little child and receive him as your Savior. And I realized, you know, I've never done that. I've never invited Jesus into my heart and life. I've never really come to a place that I said, you know, God, I really want to know you today. I want to receive you. I want to know you as my personal Savior today. I don't just want to know about you. I want to know you as my personal Savior. And that's when he opened up my heart. Maybe someone told you about it. Maybe someone come to your home and knocked on the door and told you about Jesus Christ. But no matter how you heard about Jesus Christ, this is the key. Jesus chose to let you know.
Amen.
He chose to let you know about
Amen.
Him. He can use many different avenues, but he chose you. He chose to let you know about him. By examining God's acts, by examining his principles, by examining his life, by examining his attitudes, we can know Jesus Christ. That's what's important today. Thirdly today, he tells us there's a supremacy of the privilege. Verse 22. He says, for all things are delivered to me of my Father, and no man knoweth who the Son is but the Father, and who the Father is but the Son, but to him who the Son will reveal him, as he tells us here. We must realize that what the Bible says is true.
Amen.
We must understand today that what God reveals to us is wisdom. What God shares with us is knowledge, true understanding today. He tells us that God is supreme. I want you to turn with me to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, I want to look at verses 16 and 17. It says, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions, principalities or powers. All things were created by him. All things were created for him.
Amen.
And he is before all things, and by him, all things consist. He's telling us today that God is the creator of the universe.
Amen.
God is the one that made everything we see, everything we touch, everything that we smell, everything that we understand with the senses that God has given us today. God made it.
Amen.
Okay? And we must understand that. We must receive that today, because he tells us that Christ holds the supreme place in the universe. All things have been delivered unto the hands of God's Son. He tells us that clearly. He says that all things were delivered to me of my Father. God delivered all things unto Christ. And so he says, they've been delivered unto the hands of God's Son, and they've been made for God's Son, and Jesus is the supreme authority over all the universe.
Amen.
Things you see, things you don't see. Things you understand, things you don't understand. God says that Jesus is the one that holds the supreme place in the universe. Not only that, but he tells us that he has a complete and perfect knowledge. In John chapter 7, you want to turn there with me. In John chapter 7, I want to look at verses 28 to 29. He says, "Then cried Jesus in the temple as he taught, saying, Ye both know me, and ye know whence I am. And I am not come of myself, but of him that sent me. But he that sent me is true." And what does he say there? He says, "Whom ye know not. Whom ye know not. But I know him, for I am from him, and he has sent me." That is basic to belief as a Christian. That is basic for you to receive Christ today. That you must receive him and believe that he is God, that God sent him, that he is God in person, that he came to earth to share that wisdom about God to us, that we might receive God, that we might receive him and understand who he is. So he says, through grasping the Son, through grasping the power that God has given Jesus, we can know God in his persona. He says that that's the only way to receive a complete knowledge about God is through Jesus Christ, the Son. Very clear. He also tells us that we must realize that God is a spirit. In John chapter 4, verse 24, he says, God is a spirit. He that worships him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Amen.
He is of another dimension entirely, another world, if you will. It's a spiritual world. And if we're to understand the things of God, we must step into that spiritual world. We must accept what God is telling us about that spiritual world. That's where a lot of people just get confused. And they say, I don't understand it, so why should I buy into it? I just don't believe that. You must believe what God is saying here. God is of another dimension entirely. Jesus is now of another dimension. If a man is to know the spiritual world, then God must reveal that spiritual world to him. That's why they can't understand it. That's why they can't receive it. It's a spiritual world, and it's only revealed through the Spirit.
Amen.
God said, through Jesus, said when he left, he said, I leave you the Spirit of God to be able to divulge these things to you, to be able to help you to understand these things. I will not leave you alone. I'll not leave you comfortless. I'll not leave you wondering or not understanding. I'll leave you a spirit that will be able to explain the spiritual world to you. What better way for you to learn? What better way for you to understand about spiritual things than through the Spirit? Okay? So he's very clear about that. God must reveal that to us. He must reveal that to us through his Spirit. He tells us those who will receive that are those who are humble. Those who are willing to receive it. Those who have a mind like a child. Those who will become humble. Those who will seek him. That's what he's telling us. The selected people to receive this are babes. That means those who are truly seeking God, and they're truly seeking his word. They truly believe his word. That's what he's telling us. So he tells us that there's a superiority in the privilege, and that there is those who were selected for the privilege. He tells us there's a supremacy and privilege. And he tells us last of all today, there's salvation and privilege. Verse 24. He said, "For I tell you that many prophets and kings have desired to see those things which you see, and they've not seen them, or to hear those things which you hear, and they've not heard them." He tells us that prophets were, if you will, soothsayers. Prophets were people that would predict the future, people that would try to reveal things to people. He says that the prophets desired to see the things that you see. What does he mean? He means that they believed in a coming Messiah. They believed in the Word of God. Amen. But they've never seen Him. They never was able to see Him. And that's where you and I have an advantage too. We have an advantage today because maybe we've not seen Him in person, but we understand who He is. Amen. We have more knowledge today than we've ever had in the history of man.
Amen.
To be able to understand about Jesus Christ. The disciples, he says, had a great privilege. They had a great privilege because they were eyewitnesses to what Jesus did. They were eyewitnesses to what Jesus did in healing people and seeing miracles performed and seeing Him raise the dead. They were eyewitnesses to that. They were eyewitnesses in watching Him die. They were eyewitnesses in watching Him be resurrected. That's powerful.
Amen.
That's powerful. But he says there's a privilege in seeing and learning about God's Word. There's a privilege in seeing and learning about God's full revelation. And it's all written down here for me and you. It's all recorded. So he tells us that when Jesus poured his heart out, when he shared this with his disciples, what he said was understood only by his disciples at the time. It was revealed through salvation to us. Revealed through salvation to us. What does that mean? That means that no matter how much I read this Bible, no matter how many preachers I listen to, no matter how much money I give to the kingdom of God, unless God reveals it to me, unless that Spirit reveals it to me, I'm never going to understand it. I'm never going to receive it. So he says that we're seeing it and learning it through revelation of being saved by accepting Jesus Christ into our life, allowing Him to speak to us. We begin to become understanding. It doesn't happen all at once either, in case you were wondering. Doesn't happen all at once. God continues to reveal things to us. He's revealing things to me today. I hope I'm passing some of those things along to you. But he says, in order to receive these privileges, we must receive Jesus Christ. We must receive Him. To help the disciples see this great spiritual privilege that they had, he speaks of the old saints of old, those who greatly desired to be able to see that. They greatly desired to be able to see this coming Savior, but they weren't able to see it. Scripture says very clearly, Abraham by faith received. We have over 2,000 years of knowledge, preaching, prophets, and understanding that's revealed for us in God's Word.
Amen.
That's awesome. That's awesome. We have a special privilege today that those before us did not have. They didn't have things written down for them like we do. They didn't have the opportunity to go and hear preaching like we do. They didn't have the opportunity to understand when the Scripture revealed, when Isaiah revealed to the prophets, revealed that the Son of Man would suffer. We say, "Oh, I'm suffering." No. We get to see the realization written down for us, recorded for us. We get to see it depicted in picture on a movie screen in the Passion of Christ. To be able to see, witness, understand the pain that Jesus went through. To be able to understand the suffering that He went through. We've had it reenacted for us. We've had it put before us to where we can understand it in plain English. Jesus was revealing this to His disciples because they were very specially privileged to be able to see that. They were very special privileged men to be able to walk with Him, to be able to hear Him teach, to hear Him preach, be able to see Him perform the miracles that He did. But we have it all recorded for us. Saints of old didn't have that. They didn't have that. We know what His suffering was today. We don't only know what His suffering was, but we get to experience His emotions. We get to experience His emotions as it says Jesus looked over Jerusalem. In two words, He said He wept. He wept. Strange. strikes a tender spot in my heart. Think of Jesus stood and looked over that city, and tears filled his eyes. And that joy that I explained when he started out as he complimented the Father and said, Father, you've chosen a great way to be able to share this joy. That joy was depleted as he stood there and as he looked over those who would not receive that joy.
Yeah.
Today, he wants us to realize we have a special privilege. It's a special opportunity.
Right.
Because hearing the word is not just enough. In John chapter 5, John chapter 5, verse 24, it says, when the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping and came to Capernaum seeking for Jesus. We need to seek for Jesus today. We need to look him out. We need to search for him today. Because hearing the word is not just enough. Coming to church is not enough. Reading about him is not enough. You must apply Jesus to yourself.
Amen.
You must apply him to your heart. You must place it in practice. You must place it in practice because you see, with privilege, with all the privileges that God has given us in his word, with all the understanding that he's given us, with all the wisdom that he's given us, with privilege comes opportunity and responsibility. Responsibility. We have a responsibility today to be able to understand the word of God and apply it to our lives. It's a responsibility. God wants you to understand that today. In conclusion, we can possess so much information about God today that we can understand and believe that we understand, and yet we cannot have a relationship with God. There's a lot of people in the world today that know about God, that have read his word, that have understood things about Jesus, and they don't have him in their heart. They've not received him. Our knowledge many times can cloud our view. It can keep us from seeing the reality of what God wants us to know about God. Remember, he said the only way you're going to know God is to know Jesus. The only way you're going to know God is to receive Jesus Christ, his Son, today. Jesus thanked the Father because he said it was not given to those experts, those that were wise, those that seemed to have knowledge. It was not given to them, but it was given to babes. Yet he chose those who were humble. He chose those who were ready to recognize who Christ was. Those who were ready to receive him today. Do you realize that you need God in your life? Are you tired of playing games? Have you been playing a game with God today and telling him that you know who he is? But you really don't. You really don't know who Christ is. If you don't know in your heart who Jesus is, if you don't feel him in your life today, you need to come today and invite him into your heart and life. Let me tell you how simple it is. The Bible says, for all of sin come short of the glory of God. That means that every one of us, yes, me too, I'm a sinner. But God said that if we would believe that Jesus was delivered for our offenses upon the cross and invite him into our life, he said we could be saved. And that's how simple it is. The hard part for you is making a commitment. The hard part for you is saying, you know, God, I've been wise. I've read, I've been to school, I've graduated from college, but I don't know you. I need to invite you into my life. You come today and invite Jesus into your life. Stand with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. I give you the praise and the glory for the opportunity to share the word. Father, I pray that I've shared everything you want me to share today. Father, speak to our hearts right now. Let the Holy Spirit speak to our hearts, and Father, let us be found obedient. Let us search out, Father, whether we just have a knowledge about you or whether we really know you. I pray today that everyone that leaves these doors today, Father, will know you personally. Father, we give you the praise. We give you the glory. For we ask it in Jesus' name. For his sake we pray. Amen. You come and do whatever God's laid on your heart today. I'll be here to pray with you. I can't make it any easier than this. Jesus said that if you believe in him, you must receive him. That means you must come and receive him. Invite him into your life. He's waiting for you.
Three 51.
Jesus.